Hey y'all, my name is Prashanth Kumar, or PK, and I'm an MCAT tutor at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we're going to be doing a passage walkthrough in the MCAT Chem Phys section, dealing with organic chemistry. You should be taking roughly 6.5 minutes on this passage, but today, we're going to be going more in depth and taking our time so you can see exactly what's going on in my head as we take it on. Let's get it. All right, great. So I've gone ahead and put the passage on the left and the questions we're going through on the right. So feel free to take a moment and pause the video, go at it at your own pace, and then come back to us. If not, let's get right into it. So first, let's talk strategy. I like to maintain the same exact strategy going into any passage. And the reason for this is it grounds me regardless of whether the passage is going to be easy or hard. I think having something to come back to, regardless of situation, helps improve confidence tremendously. And when you're confident, the test becomes a lot easier. For me, that strategy is to go paragraph, write a 3 to 5 word summary very quickly next to it, go on to the next paragraph, 3 to 5 word summary, and so on. The reason for this is I often found myself reading an entire passage like emptily, just reading empty words. And this causes me to reread over and over again and waste so much time on the test. By going paragraph by paragraph and doing a little check-in at the end, I'm able to have accountability, making sure I understand one paragraph before going on to the next one. And this saved a tremendous amount of time in the long run of the test. Additionally, I don't spend too much time on figures on my first read. The reason for this is that we don't know exactly what's going to be asked in the figures. It could be a small detail, it could be a broad big picture idea, we don't know. And so inevitably, if a question asks us to go back to a figure, we're gonna have to do that. So why waste too much time on that first read? Instead, just give it a little glance and then continue on. With that, I think we're ready to get started. So let's start with the first paragraph. In a new study, researchers aim to synthesize DIM derivatives-based thiazole as a new class of urease inhibitors. DIM is a natural product alkaloid used extensively in medicinal chemistry. All right, so the question I always ask myself is, what's happening? Pretty simple question, but what's happening in this paragraph, big picture? Don't get bogged down in the details, just focus on a broad, big picture understanding. So for me, I'm gonna write DIM equals urease inhibitor. And you'll note that I use abbreviation symbols. This is what you want to do. It doesn't need to make sense to anyone other than yourself. All it's got to do is make sense to you and be quick. That's it. And so already, quick summary, and we're on to the next paragraph. Researchers first synthesized several DIM-based analogs, 1 through 18, and characterized them with various spectroscopic techniques, such as 1-HNMR, 13-CNMR, and ELMS. Then the analogs were evaluated for urease, JAK bean urease inhibitory potential. All compounds showed excellent to moderate inhibitory potential with an IC50 value within the range of 0.50 plus or minus 0.01 to 33.2 plus or minus 1.2 micromolar, compared with the standard thiourea 20.60 plus or minus 0.70 micromolar. The synthetic pathway for these analogs is shown in figure 1, and then gives us a figure. So again, the big picture question is, what's happening, right? And so all I'm gonna write is DIM analogs equal good inhibitors. And then you can say spec, right? And so my idea is like, we're just taking this big picture understanding of saying these DIM analogs are good inhibitors, and we prove that by these spectroscopic techniques, right? Big picture understanding, there's so many numbers, so many different types of spectroscopies. We don't want to worry about that right now. We'll come to that if we need, but for now, let's just go on to the figure, spend a quick second looking at it and see that it's some sort of synthesis pathway with reactions and products and reactants and all that, right? Nothing too crazy. We're going to go on to the next paragraph immediately. Compound 8 was the most potent inhibitor amongst all derivatives, IC50. In the next step, researchers used X-ray crystallography to determine structure-activity relationships for the compounds. Researchers discovered that compound 8 forms a pi-sagging interaction with a conserved Y87 residue within urease. Mutation of Y87 to alanine decreases compound 8 potency by 3.7-fold. The key binding interactions of most active compounds with urease were confirmed through molecular docking studies. Okay, so what is happening? Same question we're always going to ask ourselves. And in this paragraph, all I'm just going to say is compound 8 equals best inhibitor, and then we run tests on that, right? And so this is like the big idea. We're looking at sort of DIM as an inhibitor. We show that it's a good inhibitor, and then we're looking at like the C8 as the best inhibitor. And with that, we're ready to go right into questions. So let's pull up question number one. Which of the following is not a strong acid? Is it A, hydrochloric acid, B, acetic acid, C, hydrobromic acid, or D, sulfuric acid? So this is a standalone question, meaning we don't have to go back into the passage for it. But that requires us to have some baseline understanding from our content review phases. And you'll note that there are a list of strong acids that we gotta remember. And I'm gonna write them down right here. First, we have hydrochloric acid, then we have hydrobromic acid, we have hydroiodic acid, we have sulfuric acid, we have nitric acid, perchloric acid, and chloric acid. And these are our strong acids. These are the list we're gonna have to memorize, make sure we understand. And with that, we're pretty capable of answering this question, right? We can eliminate hydrochloric, hydrobromic, and sulfuric. And we're left with acetic acid. And again, acetic acid is an acid we should know is one of the general weak acids, right? We'll probably see this in titrations coming up or acid-base chemistry, but this is a known weak acid. So right away, strong start, and we're one for one. All right, let's go to question two. During the first step of the reaction in figure one, which of the following functional groups present on the reactants is not present in the product? Is it A, an aromatic ring? Is it B, an aldehyde? Is it C, a carboxylic acid? Or is it D, an amine? Okay, so this is a question that requires us to go back to our figure, right? And this is our figure one. And we're looking at a reaction between the reactants and the product. Okay, so we have these reactants and this product. And we're looking at what doesn't match. And so this is a nice question that deals with sort of a pattern matching of sense, right? We're looking at what is gone when we put these two things together. And so I'm gonna use highlighting to help us make this, right? So we have this green part that looks aromatic, right? And that is associated with this little green part. We have this little yellow part that looks to be associated with this little yellow part, right? We have the BRBR, the NHNH, the two rings. Then we have the rings that are dealing with the carboxylic acid. And oh wait, what are we missing, right? We see this little CHO group, which is an aldehyde. But we don't have an aldehyde anywhere on this graph, right? And how does a CHO, an aldehyde group look? It just looks like a single double bond O attached to an H. And we don't see that anywhere here. We see everything else. We see the aromatic rings. We see the carboxylic acid. There isn't an example of an amine there, but we don't see it on either. So we are left with eliminating every answer except B, aldehyde. And right away, we're two for two. All right, so now let's go on to question number three. Which of the following urease position mutations at position 87 is most likely to maintain pi stacking interactions with compound 8? Is it A, alanine, B, proline, C, threonine, or D, phenylalanine? All right, so right away, we should remember what we wrote in our outline, right? This question is talking about compound 8, and we remember that was mentioned a lot in our last paragraph with it being this best inhibitor. And so now we go on to position 87, right? That was also mentioned sort of down here, and we see pi stacking. We see all these words aligning from our question to this like one area of this passage. So researchers discovered that compound 8 forms pi
stacking interaction with the conserved Y87 residue within urease. So this is our staple sentence, and we're going to come back to it by thinking of what is pi stacking, right? It says we have it maintained with this Y87 residue, but what is pi stacking? Well, pi stacking, if you remember, is a non-covalent attraction based on aromatic rings, okay? So the idea is that when compounds sort of have these aromatic rings in different residues, they sort of align and then stabilize because they align so well. And so this is a sort of form of attraction, a special form of attraction that's only related to aromatic rings. All right, so now we have to ask ourselves, okay, we're looking at position 87, and we're trying to change that from one amino acid to another amino acid. And what does that require? Well, that requires our aromatic rings to be maintained, okay? So we have what? We have Y87, and what is Y? Well, Y is tyrosine, right? Or T-Y-R. And so we should recognize this to be an amino acid with the backbone and the side chain to be an aromatic ring attached to a hydroxyl group. Okay, so what does this look like similar to? Well, we need something to have an aromatic ring. So which of our answer choices has an aromatic ring? Well, this requires us to know our backbones for each, or our side groups for each of these answer choices, right? So alanine has this carbon side group, proline is a ring, which has its own sort of special side group. Threonine has this sort of branch side group with a carbon and an OH group. And then phenylalanine is our aromatic one, right? So this is our answer. Phenylalanine simply goes like this and ends with an aromatic ring. And so we pick D because we're looking for an amino acid that can have this pi stacking group, which is only related to amino acids which have aromatic rings. And phenylalanine is our amino acid with aromatic rings. So right away, with that, we're 3 for 3. That was a challenging question that required us to know, A, what pi stacking meant, as well as what amino acids have different side groups and what they look like. So sort of a take your knowledge from content and apply it. With that, we're on to our final question, right? Researchers want to decrease the rate of production formation from the second step of the reaction in Figure 1. Which of the following would not decrease the rate of compound 2 formation according to Le Chatelier's principle? Is it A, decrease the concentration of the bromine-containing initial reactant? Is it B, decrease the concentration of the aldehyde and carboxylic acid-containing initial reactant? Is it C, decrease the concentration of compound 2? D, decrease the concentration of compound 1. All right, before we get into like the answer choices, it's important to have like a broad understanding of what Le Chatelier's principle means. And I like to break it down into this simple idea, right? If you have A going to B, okay? The idea is, what would happen if you increase A, okay? If you increase A, then you're generally gonna increase B. It just follows the same trend, right? Now, let's imagine if you decrease A, right? So you have less input. What's going to happen to B? You decrease B, okay? So this is the idea. Whatever you take and put in, if you increase that, then it's going to move in that forward direction and increase the ladder. If you decrease that, it's going to decrease the ladder. Now, what happens if you start with something on this side, right? Well, on the B side. Well, let's say you increase the B side. What's gonna happen there, right? Well, that means you're kind of saying, I have enough of this stuff. I'm increasing the amount of stuff. I don't need you to make me more. So I'm actually gonna slow the rate of reaction if I look at it from the reverse perspective, right? Same thing. If I decrease on this side, what's gonna happen? Well, I'm going to say, oh, I have a dearth or a paucity of this B. So to make up for that, I'm going to have a increase, right? To make more. And so this is the basic idea. And if we have this understanding of this like simple model, right, we can go to our reactions and work from there, right? And so I like to do this with dealing with arrows, okay? And so let's take the first thing, right? We decrease the concentration of the bromine-containing initial reactant, right? So if we decrease this, what's gonna happen down the line? Well, if we decrease that initial amount, we're gonna decrease the amount that's being made there, and we're decreasing the amount that's being made there and further on, right? And so the question asked is asking specifically about compound two formation. And that means we're looking at this spot, right? So what is happening at this spot? Well, by our sort of trend of arrows, we see that that amount is decreasing. So right away, we can eliminate A. And we start over with our arrow trends again. Okay, decrease the concentration of the aldehyde and carboxylic acid containing initial reactant. Well, it's the same exact idea, right? This is this reactant. If we decrease this, we're gonna decrease this, we're gonna decrease this, and decrease this. Okay, so that means we can eliminate B, because again, we see our trend of arrows resulting in a decreased amount of product two. Next, we have decreasing the concentration of compound two. And this is the exact sort of second reaction we said, right? If we decrease the amount of B, we're gonna have to increase the amount of everything before it to make up for it. So let's say we start with this decreased amount here. That results in this increasing to make up for it, right? We wanna make up for that initial decreased amount, and eventually this is going to increase the amount of product too. And this is a sort of complicated idea, right? Because it's counterintuitive, because we were saying, oh, if we decrease it early on, that means we should expect to see a decrease. But now we're seeing a decrease later on, resulting in an increase early, and early causes the increase to product two. So this indirect sort of pathway is exactly what Le Chatelier's principle is saying. So C is looking like a great answer. But let's go on to our answer choice D just to make sure. So here it's saying let's decrease compound number one. And by our same trend, we see decrease there results in a decrease of product two and a decrease at the end. And so as a result, we can eliminate D and we're left with answer choice C. And we've done it. We're 4 for 4. Very challenging question, but having that important understanding of what's going on with Le Chatelier's principle is a necessity for the MCAT. Great work, team. Crushed it. All right, great work, team. We crushed another challenging Orgo passage. Everyone's hardest subject, but we did it. We got a great understanding of some functional groups, Le Chatelier's principle, amino acids, all of that. So kudos for you for getting it done, and great work. If you like this video, give it a like and subscribe down to our channel. Comment down below exactly what videos and walkthroughs you want to see next. Definitely check out Vikram's 528 strategy series so you can prep in the best and most efficient way possible for your MCAT. And also sign up for our MCAT question of the day down below so you don't miss out on any studying before test day. Happy studying, and let's get it.